Hello, everybody. Hello. May please be seated. Please be seated. Good morning. Good morning. We're getting ready for our presentations this morning, and my duty is twofold: to get you to sit down and then to lead you in prayer. So if we can begin to go to our seats, please. It's wonderful to see all of you again. Are we ready to pray? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God and Father of us all, in Jesus, your Son and our Savior, you have made us your sons and daughters in the family of the Church. May your grace and love help our families in every part of the world be united to one another in fidelity to the gospel. May the example of the Holy Family, with the aid of your Holy Spirit, guide all families, especially those most troubled, to be homes of communion and prayer, and to always seek your truth and live in your love, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus, Mary, and Joseph, pray for us.
I was watching a documentary about the great temples of Ramses II in Luxor, Karnak, Abu Simbel. And the documentary was talking about how extraordinary these buildings were. And I wondered, how was it that this mightiest empire of the ancient world didn't survive, but Jews somehow did? And I suddenly realized that they both asked this most fundamental question any civilization can ask, which is, how does something of us live on? And Jews said to become immortal, you don't need to build monuments of stone. All you have to do is engrave your values on the hearts of your children and they on theirs until the end of time.
Man and woman coming together, two in one, but then giving rise to a third, the child. That's one of the great images of the Trinity in the tradition. How often we hear that God wants to marry his people. Extraordinary thing. Only in the biblical tradition do we find this idea. And it's grounded in the fact that the coming together of the two as one reflects the very being of God.
I can't put across how he has saved my life in words, but I'll just try. I'm incomplete without my husband. The expression of love has to flow towards a being from God. So he is that being that my love will flow to. It's because of him that I am married. And it's because I am married that I have children. And because I have him and I have my children, I can love. To say yes to that call from God is to love them. And loving them is making my salvation come true.
Life becomes rich when we move outside of that little narrow framework into wider worlds. Sexuality and relationship has always done that. When you marry and decide to have children, you say, well, my life isn't about me anymore. It's about my wife, it's about my children. Sex and relationship and children have, from time immemorial, been seen as a privileged route into these wider worlds. It's the foundation for society. Press it further. It links you to nature. You're part of something so much bigger than yourself and your own desires. You're now a vehicle in the very propagation of the human race. Press it even further. It goes all the way to God, right? So it's God that gives the command in Genesis, be fruitful and multiply. Sexuality, relationship, children makes you part of God's overall design for the world.
The first circle is that family, then the extended family, the community, the society. The circle keeps increasing, it keeps widening. So anything positive from my marriage does not just affect my husband and I and the children. It goes round into my family, his family, society, and the world. Then if it's negative, it is the same thing. That is why We need to see marriage as a sacrifice. It is your own project for the world.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. What a joy. All right, can you hear me now? Yes. Good morning, brothers and sisters. It is my honor to bring us to this particular session, which is unique and climactic for our world meeting of families. The theme is the joy of the gospel of life, and we have two presenters for the session, Cardinal Seán Patrick O'Malley, as well as Pastor Richard or Rick Warren. I want to introduce both speakers here at the outset of the session and then invite you to prayerfully listen carefully to the wisdom that we have to share. Cardinal Seán Patrick O'Malley, the Archbishop of Boston. He was born in 1944 in Lakewood, Ohio. He was ordained a priest in 1970 and holds a master's degree in religious education and a doctorate in Spanish and Portuguese literature. As a young priest in the Archdiocese of Washington, he was director of the Apostolate for Hispanics. He received episcopal ordination on August 2, 1984, and was made Bishop of St. Thomas. In 1992, he became Bishop of Fall River, Massachusetts, and in 2002, he was appointed Bishop of Palm Beach, and finally in 2003, he was appointed as Archbishop of Boston. Dr. Rick Warren is pastor of Saddleback Church in Lake Forest, California. He is the author of the best-selling book, The Purpose-Driven Life, along with 10 other titles. He's also the founder of the Global Peace Plan, promote reconciliation, equip leaders, assist the poor, care for the sick, and educate the next generation. He established the Purpose-Driven Network of Churches and has trained over 400,000 priests and pastors in 197 countries. Let's welcome our presenters.
Good morning. Your Eminences, Your Excellencies, brothers and sisters in Christ, I want to thank first Pope Francis and Archbishop Chaput for inviting me to this great convention congress. I want to thank Cardinal O'Malley for allowing me to share the stage with him. It's a big honor to do that in this last session. And I want to thank you. Thank you for caring about the family. Thank you for caring about the family enough to be here. Have I told you lately that I love you? Last November, Pope Francis invited me to be the closing speaker at his conference on the family at the Vatican. And at that conference, Pope Francis was the very first speaker. I was the last. He was the very first speaker. And he made a statement that I've never forgotten. He said, today families are being threatened. They're being threatened within, and they're being threatened without. On Wednesday, I was invited to the White House to be there when the Holy Father arrived and spoke there on the South Lawn. And he said it again. He said it when he arrived in America. Today families are being threatened from within and from without. And so I began to think about that, and I made a little list of what is it that is threatening our families. And I thought, today in our culture, materialism is idolized, immorality is glamorized, truth is minimized, sin is normalized, divorce is rationalized, and abortion is legalized. In TV and movies, crime is sensationalized, drugs are legitimized, comedy is vulgarized, and sex is trivialized. In movies, the Bible is fictionalized, churches are satirized, God is marginalized, and Christians are demonized. These are enemies. Then, also in our society, I wrote, elderly are dehumanized, the sick are euthanized, the poor are victimized, the mentally ill are ostracized, immigrants are stigmatized, and children are tranquilized. Then I wrote, our families now live in a world where manners are uncivilized, speech is vulgarized, education is secularized, advertising is centralized, and everything is commercialized. Now, unfortunately, Christians, you and I, we're often disorganized and we're demoralized. Our faith is compartmentalized and our witness is compromised. So what do we need? What we need is to revitalize our worship. We need to minimize our differences. We need to mobilize our members. We need to evangelize the lost, and we need to re-energize our families. The Bible clearly teaches we overcome evil with good. And rather than simply being opponents of what's wrong, we should be proponents of what's right. And we need to celebrate good marriages, good families, and what God is doing in the sacraments and the sanctity of life, the sanctity of marriage, and the sanctity of family. Now, the theme for this last session is the joy of the gospel life. And before Cardinal O'Malley speaks, I just want to give a couple of brief comments on what is it that creates a joy-filled family. Let me just give you a few things after 40 years in ministry that I have noticed. What creates a joy-filled family? Number one, joy-filled families are based on the love of God. They live it, they experience it, they enjoy it, they model it, and they offer it to others, the joy of God. Now, the Bible says that God is love. It doesn't say God has love, it says God is love. It is the essence of his character. It is his nature. God is love. The only reason there's love in the universe, the only reason you have love in your family is because your Creator made you in his image. If God was not a God of love, there would be no love in the universe. God is love. And the Bible tells us that you were created as an object of God's love. You want to know why your heart is beating? You know why you're taking your next breath? Because you were made to be loved by God. If God had not wanted to love you, you would not exist. Now, God didn't need you. God lived in the perfect relationship with himself, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in a loving relationship to himself. God didn't need you, but he wanted you. And that shows how much you matter to God. Now, God's love for you is unconditional. It isn't based on what you do. It's based on what Christ has done on the cross. It's not based on who you are. It's based on who he is. God's love is unconditional. And not only is it unconditional, it's eternal. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will never stop loving you. You can't make God stop loving you. You can try, but you will fail. Because again, it's based on who he is, not who you are. You will never really understand how much God loves you. No woman will ever love you the way Jesus Christ loves you. No man will ever love you the way Jesus Christ loves you. In fact, God loves you more than you love you. And if we were to try to spend the entire week understanding the love of God, we couldn't. It's kind of like an ant trying to understand the internet. My brain isn't big enough. Psalm 149, verse 4 says, the Lord takes pleasure in his people. How many of you are parents? Can I see your hands? How many of you take pleasure in your children? You say, most of the time. You know, when my children were small, I used to go sneak into their bedroom at night, and I would sit by their bed, and I would simply watch them breathe. And I would watch their little chest rise and lower, rise and lower, rise and lower. And that gave me so much pleasure. Why? Because I am their father. I created them. Now, they didn't have to do anything special for me to love them. They didn't have to be quoting scripture. They didn't have to be witnessing to their faith. They didn't have to be saying their prayers. I loved them while they were sleeping. Did you know that that's the way God loves you? You don't always have to be doing something religious. He loves you in your up days and your down days. He loves you when you feel it and you don't feel it. He loves you on your bad hair days and your good hair days. Because his love for you is so great. And just as we take pleasure in our kids, your heavenly Father takes pleasure in you. I now play a game with my grandkids. I've played it so many times they know the answer. I'll grab one of my grandkids and I'll say to them, "Do you know what I love about you?" And they will say, "Everything." And I say, "That's right." Because I've told them that so many times. I said, "There is nothing about you that I do not love." Because I want them to feel safe and secure in that love. Now, the Bible says in Ephesians 1:4, long before he laid down the earth's foundation, God had us in mind and settled on us as the focus of his love. The other day, I was counseling a young man from our church, and he had fallen into some areas of sin. And he said, "You know, I guess my problem is I just don't love God enough." And I said, "Steve, that's not your problem. Your problem is not that you don't love God enough. Your problem is you don't understand how much he loves you. Because if you did, you couldn't help but love him. You couldn't help but fall at his feet and worship him." Now, you as a parent, your first duty, listen, your first duty is to let God love you. We love because he first loved us. Let God love you. And then your second job is to love him back. And then your third job is to offer that love to your own family and to everyone around you. One time I was speaking at a prison, 5,000 prisoners out on a yard. And I had to get their attention and nobody was paying attention. So I took a $50 bill out of my pocket and I held it up and I said, "Would anybody like this $50 bill?" 5,000 hands went up in the prison yard. I took that bill and I crumpled it all up and I tore it a little bit. "Anybody still want this $50 bill?" 5,000 hands went up. I spit on the $50 bill, I threw it on the ground and I stomped it in the dirt. And I picked it up and said, "Anybody still want this $50 bill?" 5,000 hands went up. Now I had their attention. I said, "This represents some of you. You were spit on, you've been kicked around. Maybe you were told by your own father, you don't matter, you're worthless, you don't amount to anything. And you've done some dumb things yourself, and that's why you're here in prison. And you've been beaten up, and you've been dirtied, and you've been sullied, but you have not lost one cent of your value to your heavenly Father. Joy-filled families. And this is the gospel of joy and the joyful life. Joy-filled families base their family on the love of God. They live it, they express it, and they enjoy it through life. Number two, joy-filled families are built on purpose. Now, I don't have time to go into this one. I did write a little book about it. But I will tell you this. God has never created anything without a purpose. Every plant has a purpose. Every animal has a purpose. Every rock has a purpose. And if your heart is beating right now, God has a purpose for your life. God does not make things without purpose. And the goal of a family, as a mini church, as Catholics call it, a domestic church, is to help everyone in that family discover God's purpose for their life. Now, if you want to know God's purpose, you've got to begin with God. Some people say, "Oh, you know, if you want to know your purpose, look within." I tried that. It doesn't work. I looked within and didn't like what I saw. A lot of darkness and a lot of problems. You can't tell yourself what your purpose is because you didn't make you. Does that make sense? There's only two ways to know your purpose in life. If I were to hold up an invention here, you'd never see it. You wouldn't know the purpose. The only way you'd know the purpose is either A, read the owner's manual, or B, talk to the inventor, the creator. And that's the only way you'll know your purpose in life, is to read God's word and to talk to your heavenly Father who created you and made you. Jesus told us that every person has a purpose. The Bible says in Ephesians 1:11, it is in Christ that we find out who we are and what we're living for. Part of his overall purpose, he's working out in everything and everyone. And Colossians 1:16 says this, everything, absolutely everything, got started in Christ and finds its purpose in him. Now listen very closely. You were made by God, and you were made for God. And until you understand that, life will never make sense. It's not about you. It's all about God and his greatness and his grace and his glory. And you were made to last forever. It is not an understatement to say God has long-range plans for you. You were made to last forever. In fact, you're going to spend more time on that side of eternity than you will on this side. If we were to judge our life today with eternity, if we were to stretch a line from Philadelphia to Tokyo, the first mini millimeter of that line would be your life on Earth, the 60, 80, at 100 years that you get here. It's nothing compared to the trillions and trillions and trillions of years you're going to spend in eternity. So what does God do? Have you ever thought about this? Why didn't God just create us and take it to heaven first place? Why did he put us here first? Because he wants us to learn some things. And he wants us to practice on earth what we're going to do in heaven. You're going to worship in heaven. God wants you to practice on earth. You're going to serve God in heaven, so he wants you to practice on earth, so you're not a doofus when you get there. You're going to fellowship with other believers in heaven. God wants you to learn how to fellowship here. These are things that God wants us to do. Joy-filled families are built on purpose. And God wants you to do that. Number three, joy-filled families focus on becoming like Christ. One of God's purposes for your life is to make you like his son. You were created to become like Christ. Spiritual formation, discipleship, edification, exhortation, education, all of these things are to form the mind of Christ in you. Once you understand it, it's going to make a whole lot of sense life. Because God wants you to grow up spiritually. God is more interested in your character than your comfort. You know, a lot of times we ask, why is this happening to me? And we go through pain and problems and trials and temptations and all kinds of difficulties in life. Well, I'll tell you why. To make you like Christ. The Bible tells us in the book of Hebrews, Jesus learned obedience through suffering. How do you think you're going to learn it? The Bible says in Hebrews, Jesus was made perfect through suffering. How do you think you're going to learn that? You're not going to take your car to heaven. You're not going to take your career to heaven. You're not going to take your cash to heaven. You are going to take your character. That's you. And God says, I want you to grow in Christ's likeness. Romans 8:29, from the very beginning, God decided that those who came to him, and all along he knew who would, should become like his son. Colossians 1:15, we look at the son and find find God's original purpose in everything created. This has been God's plan from the very beginning. The very first thing God said to himself was, let us make man in our image. It has always been God's desire to make us in his image. Now, don't misunderstand me. Not God. You're not going to become a god, but to become godly. There are some who believe out there, you become a god. You're not a god. You're not even a mini-me God. You're never going to be a mini-me God. If you're a God, why don't you just change everything and solve everybody's problems? No, you're not. That's not New Age. That's an old lie. It's been around since the garden when Satan, you know, Satan, when he tempts you, doesn't tempt you to do evil. He doesn't say, hey, eat this fruit and you'll be like me. No, he says, eat this fruit and you'll be a god. And he's been saying that ever since. Now the Bible says in Philippians 2 verse 4, in your lives you must think and act like Christ Jesus. What is Jesus like? Well, I think the best description of our Lord is the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and patience and gentleness and goodness, faith, meekness, self-control. How does God produce those character qualities of Christ in your life? How does God produce love in your life? Am I just walking down the street one day and all of a sudden, zap, I'm just filled with love and I love everybody? No, it doesn't work that way. Listen very closely. The way God produces the fruit of the Spirit in your life is by putting you in the exact opposite situation. If God's going to teach you real love, he's going to put you around some unlovely people. Don't look at them. Be cool. Don't elbow them. It's easy to love people like you, people who are cool. But if God's going to teach you real love, he'll put you around some unlovely people. How about joy? You learn joy in the middle of grief. Joy is different from happiness. Happiness depends on happenings. I go to Disneyland, I'm happy. I come out, I realize how much I spent. I'm not happy anymore. Joy is internal and eternal. It's not external. How about peace? It's easy to be peaceful when you're out fishing. And boy, it doesn't get any better than this. God will teach you peace when the beans are burning and the baby's crying and somebody knocks at the door and the dog bites the cat and the cat bites the head off the Barbie doll and there's chaos. You learn peace in the middle of chaos. How about patience? How does God teach you patience? Department of Motor Vehicles. You know, Have you ever been in a hurry when God wasn't? That is the most difficult season of life, when you're sitting in God's waiting room. God is never in a hurry. We don't have any recollection of Jesus ever running anywhere. He just didn't run. One time his best friend Lazarus dies. It takes him 3 days to get there. Come on, it's only 5 miles away. That's what you call slow poking around. But he had a bigger plan, and God has a bigger plan in your life. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:18, as the Spirit of the Lord works within us, we become more and more like him. And more than anything else, that's what I want in my life. I want to reflect the character of Jesus Christ. I love Jesus Christ with all my heart. And if he never did anything else for me, I owe him the rest of my life. And you do too. And God wants us to become like Christ. Number four, joy-filled families serve together. The Bible tells us that the family is meant to be a launch pad for ministry, that we serve individually, but we also serve together as families. Now the question becomes, how do I serve a God I can't see? Well, Jesus made it very clear. We serve God by serving others. I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick and in prison, and you visited me. Inasmuch as you have done it unto these, the least of my brethren, you have done it unto me. We serve God by serving others. God wants you to practice on earth serving him by serving others, because you're going to serve God in eternity. And the Bible says in Ephesians 2:10, God made us what we are. In Christ Jesus, God made us to do good works, which he planned in advance for us to live our lives doing. Those good works are called your service or your ministry. Now, not everybody's a priest, but everybody is called to serve. Everybody is called to minister. And God puts you on this planet to make a contribution. Anytime, Jesus said, if you give a cup of cold water in my name, that counts. That counts. That's an act of service. 1 Peter 4:10, God has given each of you some special abilities. Be sure to use them to help each other, passing on to others God's many kinds of blessing. As I said, you practice serving here, because when you get to heaven, you're going to serve God. A lot of people have a false conception of heaven. If you ever watch a movie, heaven is always completely white. Have you noticed this? There's no color in heaven. Now, figure out, God invented sunsets, and he's not going to have color in heaven? Really? And so the modern movie idea of heaven is you're walking in clouds, and the dust comes up about this high. You're in a white robe with angel's wings, and you're playing a harp. Really? To me, honestly, that would be hell to me. If that's what heaven is like, no, heaven, you're going to love God, you're going to worship God, you're going to serve God. The Bible has a lot to say, but it's far more than you imagine. No man can see or understand it. But we're to practice serving here. One of my favorite stories, I heard this in college, and it changed my life. is the story of the great Bishop Fulton Sheen. One time Bishop Sheen was in Africa and he was visiting a leprosy colony, and there were people in that colony who not only had leprosy but had other skin diseases as well. And he walked up to one young man, or older man, who was laying on the ground with just a loincloth around himself, and he had not only leprosy but a number of other skin diseases because he had open pussy sores on his legs that were oozing. And Bishop Sheen leaned over to talk to this man, and the chain of his crucifix broke and the cross fell into a man's open sore on the man's leg. And Bishop Sheen said, initially, I was revolted by that. He said, the imagery of that crucifix in that man's wound was just revolting to me. And then he said, all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit filled me with love for that man. And I reached into the sore and I took up the cross. When I heard that phrase as an 18-year-old boy, I thought, that is the finest definition of Christian living I've ever heard. Because the whole business of life is to go out into the sores of life where people are bleeding and dying and hurting and take up the cross. That is our ministry. That is our service. And finally, if you want a joy-filled family, you want a joy-filled family, you base it on God's love, you build it on God's purposes, you use it as a launch pad to serve God, you use it as a school to grow in grace and to grow in God and to grow in Christ and to build your character. And number five, joy-filled families fulfill their mission. You've seen it on every corner. Our mission is love. Our mission is love. God puts you on this planet to know Him, then to learn to love Him, then to learn to grow in Him, then to learn to serve Him, and then to learn to share Him. And that sharing is our mission. Jesus in John 17, verse 18 said, in the same way that the Father gave me a mission in the world, I give them a mission in the world. You have a mission. Acts 20, 24, St. Paul says this, I consider my life will be wasted unless I use it to complete my mission and finish the assignment that the Lord Jesus has given me to tell everyone the good news about God's grace. And the fact is, friends, there are people who will never hear about Jesus Christ unless your family tells them. You are the only Bible some people will ever read. You must be a living Bible. And I want to tell you, having been in 164 countries, that everybody is hungry for the good news. They may have intentional barriers put up that look like they're not interested, but everybody is hungry for the gospel. Many years ago, I was invited to a state dinner in my honor in Tiananmen Square in Beijing. And after I finished that state dinner, the University of Beijing, it's called actually University of Peking, the only thing still called Peking in Beijing, which is the Harvard of China, invited me to come and debate their scholars. And so we went over and we had a friendly discussion and debate. And after it was over, I learned that the provost of Peking University, the Harvard of China, 50,000 students, was dying of a brain tumor. So I invited him out to lunch. And we went out to lunch together. And this man had been teaching communist belief for now, 50 years. And as we began to talk and he began to explain that he was dying of this brain tumor, I said, sir, my father is dying of cancer right now. But he's not afraid to die. He's made his peace with God. He knows where he's going when he dies. He has a living, vibrant relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. And I told him this story. I said, I know about a friend of mine, a man, who took his son to the carnival for his son's birthday. And he bought a big roll of tickets, and he took his son and his son's three best friends. And at every ride, he would give his son a ticket and give his three best friends a ticket. And they'd ride the ride. Then they'd go to the next ride, and the father would give his son a ticket and his three best friends a ticket. And they'd ride the next ride. And they were doing this all day for a birthday party. He said, on about the seventh ride, I looked down, and he said, there was a fourth little hand sticking out for a ticket. And I said, who are you, to this little boy? And the little boy said, I'm your son's new friend. And your son told me that if I was his friend, his father would give me a ticket. He said, you think I gave that guy a ticket? Of course I did. I said, Professor Joe, your heavenly father has a ticket for you to heaven. You can't buy it. You can't earn it. You'll never deserve it. It's paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ on the cross. But if you become a friend of God's son, Jesus Christ, he will give you that ticket. And I looked over, and this man, tears were coming down his eyes, and he said in broken English, I would like one of those tickets. And I remember, I didn't know if he was just being polite, because Chinese people are very polite, or if he really meant it. So I said, let's do this. If you're really serious about opening your life up to the love and grace of Jesus Christ, I would be happy to pray with you. Why don't we wait till the end of the meal? And if at the end of the meal, if you're still interested in doing this, it would be my honor to pray with you. Well, we finished the meal, and he said, I want to open up my life to the grace of Jesus Christ. And so I bowed heads with him and led him in a very simple prayer of faith. The next day, I was preaching at the most famous church in China, Chongwenmen Church in China. It's a giant church. President Bush, when he was an ambassador there, went there. Billy Graham and President Clinton, many people have visited this church. And as I stood up to speak in a very large crowd, in walked this professor. And he walked to the front of the church, and he turned around, and he said, I am publicly professing my faith in Jesus Christ. Fifty years of communism couldn't fill the hole in his heart. I conclude with this story. My father was a pastor, and he was an average preacher, but he was a great carpenter. And in his lifetime, he built over 150 church buildings literally all around the world. A few years ago, my father was dying of cancer, as I told you, and we brought him home rather than have him in the hospital, and we were doing our own hospice. And the last week of his life, the tumor began to eat at his brain and his body, and he began to dream aloud. He would, in a dreamlike state for a week, and he would dream aloud. You can learn a lot about somebody listening to their dreams for a week. And it's interesting that my dad never talked about fishing, which was his favorite hobby. He never talked about being a hero in World War II, which he was. He never talked about the books he read, the movies he'd seen. He talked about what meant the most to him, building churches. And he talked about taking teams all around the world and building young churches. And when he did this, as he did this, he began to say, move these beams over here and let's get there and let's make sure the volunteers get their lunch. The night before he died, my father became very agitated. And all of a sudden he tried to get out of bed. He had lost a lot of weight. He was very gaunt from his cancer. He tried to get out of bed, and my wife and my niece, Alyssa, and I were in the room together. And he tried to get out of bed, and my wife said, Jimmy, you can't get out of bed. You're sick. Whatever you need, tell us. We'll bring it to you. But he kept trying to get out of bed. He was really agitated, trying to get out of bed. And my wife said, Jimmy, whatever you need, we'll bring it to you. You don't need to get out of bed. And he just kept trying to get out of bed and very, very adamant. And finally, my wife got a little blunt, and she said, Jimmy, you're dying. And you can't get out of bed. Whatever you need, what is it that you want? And my father said, gotta save one more for Jesus. Gotta save one more for Jesus. One more for Jesus. one more for Jesus. And he began to say this over and over. I'm not exaggerating. In the next hour, my father said this phrase maybe 150 times. One more for Jesus. One more for Jesus. Save one more for Jesus. Reach one more for Jesus. I was sitting by my father's bedside and I put my head down and I began to cry, thanking God for a godly heritage and for a man who was talking about Christ in his dying words. And my father lifted up his frail hand and he put it on my head like a blessing. And he said to me, one more for Jesus. Reach one more for Jesus. I intend for that to be the theme of the rest of my life. And I invite for you to make it the theme of the rest of your life, that we recover the mission of the church, the new evangelization, and we reach one more for Jesus as families full of joy. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you, Your Eminence.
Love you.
Yesterday, speaking to Congress, our Holy Father underscored the importance of the family for our human society and said, as the pastor has just quoted, the family has never been so threatened. I just want to begin by thanking all of you for your participation in this conference on the family. Many of you are involved in marriage preparation, pro-life activities, and marriage enrichment. Thank you for all that you do to strengthen our families. Pastor Rick Warren has given us a beautiful reflection. It's been a steak dinner, a little filet mignon, and now I'm supposed to give you a hamburger, maybe a slider here. The Holy Father invites all of us to live the joy of the gospel and to become missionary disciples. Beauty and joy are the most powerful tools that we have to evangelize. So together, we want to dream of a world where the beauty of family life attracts people to make a gift of themselves in marriage, to build a domestic church that will continue to build a civilization of love. When I was bishop in the West Indies, we were celebrating the 50th anniversary of a wonderful married couple in the parish. After 50 years, they were still very much in love with each other and radiated a spirit of joy and enthusiasm that was truly an inspiration to the whole parish. Before celebrating the Mass, I asked Alfonso about his long and successful marriage. I asked him what was the key to success. He said, Bishop, when my wife and I were married, we decided that all the decisions that we would make in a scientific fashion and hence avoid all unnecessary arguments. I said, well, how did you do that? He said, very simple. We agreed that I would make all the big decisions and my wife would make all of the little decisions. I said, and how has that worked for you? He said, it's worked very well, but you know, there haven't been any big decisions yet. In reality, the big decision is love. As Pope Benedict says in Deus Caritas Est, we have come to believe in God's love. In these words, the Christian can express the fundamental decision of his life. Yes, the fundamental decision of our life is to love God who first loved us and to love our neighbor as ourselves. In God's plan, the family is the school of love, where we learn to make a gift of ourselves to the Lord and to others, like Jesus' sacrificial love on the cross, which is the source of our life as disciples. The decision to love is born out of an encounter with the living God, whose love is fundamental for our lives and raises important questions about who God is and who we are. Years ago, when I was teaching Spanish literature, I always liked to talk about a novel called Marianela by Perez Galdós. The story is about a young woman in the village in Spain who has a great capacity for love and friendship and goodness. She has a boyfriend by the name of Pablo who happens to be blind. She cooked for Pablo, she took him for walks, she read to him, she was his constant companion. One day his family was able to send him off to the big city, was operated on and cured of his blindness. And when he returns to his village, for the first time in his life, he sees this young woman who loves him more than anyone else in the world ever could or ever would. But now that Pablo can see, he realizes there's other young ladies in the village who are prettier than she is. And he eventually leaves her and marries someone else. The irony of the story is, of course, that when Pablo was blind, he could see. He could see the beauty and the goodness and the love of Marianela. But when he could see with his eyes, he could only see what was on the surface. He could only see appearances, and appearances often deceive us. We need to be able to see the world through God's eyes, to see what is really real, what's really beautiful, to see what is really important. It's the vision of faith that allows us to make the right decisions, decisions about life, about our vocation, about mission, about our response to God's love. As Pope Francis says in Evangelii Gaudium, the joy of the gospel, for if we have received the love which restores meaning to our lives, how can we fail to share that love with others? Pope Francis makes it clear that our call to discipleship is a call to be missionary disciples. We're faithful to our mission as Christ's family only by inviting others to be a part of that mission, by helping families become what they are. In God's plans, families are missionaries. They pass on the faith to new generations and share with their new members the treasures and legacies that we have received. Marriage in God's plan is the sanctuary of life, and the family is a community of love. That's a very important part of the gospel message, of the good news that we must live and proclaim. Pope Paul VI said, the family, like the church, ought to be a place where the gospel's transmitted and from which the gospel radiates. In a family which is conscious of this mission, all the members evangelize and we are evangelized. The parents not only communicate the gospel to their children, but from their children they can receive the same gospel deeply lived by them. And such a family becomes an evangelizer of many families. We're all privileged to have known such families as described by Pope Paul VI. One such family that made a very profound impression on me as a young seminarian was the Gashaw family. They were members of Dorothy Day's Catholic Worker Movement. They had six children of their own and adopted a child. And on the farm where they lived in Akron, Ohio, they took in dozens of severely handicapped children whose parents were unable to care for them. Bill and Dorothy taught their own children how to love and care for these needy children who became their brothers and sisters. It was truly a labor of love. I will never forget the impact that it made on me the first time I visited their home and saw those terribly deformed children receiving so much love in that family. And indeed, those very children were eliciting that love and were themselves a blessing and a grace. Being a family in God's family is to be a community of love where people learn to make a gift of themselves to God and to others. Those beautiful families change the course of history. They open the door that allows God's light to enter our world, and their witness helps us to be open to life. When I was in the seminary, our provincial Father Victor wrote a letter to Rome and said he wanted a new mission, and he said, make it the most difficult mission in the world. The response was lightning quick, and our friars were sent to the highlands of Papua New Guinea. When they arrived there, they were the first Europeans to be in that part of that very isolated island. They got down from the airplane, and a number of natives came out of the bush and, through an interpreter, asked whether the plane was a male or a female. They said, if it's a female, we want an egg. Oftentimes, because of our technological superiority, we delude ourselves into thinking we're better, smarter than people from the developing world. That's far from the truth. That was brought home to me in a very dramatic way when our first group of missionaries in Papua New Guinea shared an extraordinary story about a group of natives who'd become Catholics in our mission. One day they traveled very far from the mission, and they encountered other natives from another part of the island. And they discovered that these people were also Christians, but they weren't Catholics. They were Lutherans. They returned to our mission and told the friars how disappointed they were to learn that Jesus' disciples were not united. They were scandalized to realize that such divisions existed. The friars were embarrassed and ashamed. When they told us of this incident, we too felt embarrassed that we were so complacent and indifferent to the scandal of division among Christ's followers. These primitive natives immediately saw the tragedy and the contradiction of this situation. Christ longed for unity and fraternity among his disciples, and we've come to accept division as something normal, unremarkable, inevitable. We have so much to learn from these simple natives who grasp the meaning of the gospel and reject the notion of disunity. At the Last Supper, Jesus washed the disciples' feet and he gave us the new commandment to love one another as he loves us. He prays, Father, that all might be one as you and I are one, so that the world will believe that you sent me. If the world does not believe, in part is because we are not united. I'm so pleased that Pastor Rick is with us for this conference. This is a witness of unity that's important in today's world as we strive to proclaim the gospel of life, the need to protect every human being from the first moment of conception until natural death, to defend the family, to defend the family as a sanctuary of life, and marriage as a sacred contract described on the first pages of the Bible as a man who leaves his mother and father to be joined in one flesh to his wife. It's a great consolation. It's a great consolation to stand on this stage with a fellow Christian who's committed to teaching the gospel. We're truly blessed by his witness and his friendship. If Father Provincial wrote today asking for the most difficult mission in the world, I don't think we'd be sent to Papua New Guinea, but probably to the United States and other places in the Western world where de-Christianization is gaining ground. We inhabit the new mission territories of the church. We need to find a way to bring the gospel to the contemporary world of proclaiming Christ anew and of implanting the faith. Our task is to turn consumers into disciples and disciple makers. We need to prepare men and women who will witness the faith and not send people into the witness protection program. We need to equip our people to be disciples. They need to know the truth of the faith, but they also need to know how to live those truths. The way most of us become real Christians is by looking over someone else's shoulder, emulating an admired older member of our family or our parish, saying yes and taking up a way of life that is made real and accessible through the witness of someone else. We learn to be disciples the way we learn a language, by living in a community that speaks that language. We live in a world obsessed by celebrities, a world where all too often celebrities have replaced heroes and heroines. Oftentimes, these celebrities, for all their good looks and talent and singing or acting or sports, lead lives that are superficial, self-absorbed, and chaotic. In contrast, the church has always held up for us the lives of the saints as examples of the universal call to holiness. The saints model for us the struggle to overcome human weakness and sinfulness and to embrace God's will in our lives. In the four Gospels, there's a contrast between what we might designate the crowd and the community. The crowd is a collection of individuals motivated by self-interest, thrown together by circumstances, and often unfeeling and indifferent. In the gospel, we read of the beggar Bartimaeus, or the vertically challenged Internal Revenue Service chief Zacchaeus, who tried to draw near to Jesus, but the crowd pushed them away. The crowd always pushes away. The community draws people closer to Christ. As a child, my favorite gospel story was the episode where the crowd was so great that people could not bring the paralytic man to Jesus. So they went up to the roof, opened a hole, and lowered him down. I thought to myself, gee, I'd like to have friends like that. But I'd also like to be a friend like that. Yes, the gospel, the crowd is pushing people away from the Lord, and the community is ever helping people to draw near. Our task is to change the crowd into a community. That's what evangelization is about. And it must begin with our families. Transforming a collection of individuals into a community, a domestic church, where we pray together, share our faith, where we know how to forgive and show unconditional love. All too often, the subliminal message of helicoptering parents is, if you excel in everything, then you will deserve my love. In families, we learn to forgive, to share, to nurture. We need to gather the family around the table to have time together. And we also need to gather around the Eucharistic table. At the table and the altar, we learn our identity and find the strength to truly be who we are and make a gift of ourselves, to experience unconditional love and to love unconditionally. Pope Francis, in his last encyclical, Laudato Si, urges us to care for our common home and to take care of the gifts, to be protectors of the gifts. He so often urges us to take care of each other. That's why we're here, to build a civilization of love, to be that field hospital that makes present the merciful love of Christ. I often share with people the story of a man who went to the doctor for a series of tests because he was very sick. The doctor said, I want to talk to your wife. And he said, your husband will survive only if you take very, very good care of him. She said, what do you mean, doctor? He said, well, if you serve him his favorite meals, if you let him go on hunting and fishing trips and to sports events, give him the remote control for the television set, don't let the kids bother him, keep his mother-in-law away, If you do all of these things, there's a very good chance your husband will survive. On the way home in the car, the husband was very nervous and upset. He said, "What did the doctor say? What did the doctor say?" She said, "Honey, the doctor said you're gonna die." We are on this earth with a mission to take care of each other, to build a civilization of love. And if we don't do that, the patient will die. Today, we find inspiration in so many faith-filled men and women who have gone before us. Now, let us recommit ourselves to the mission, the task of being missionary disciples, passing on the treasure of the faith to generations to come. May we be as generous and as faithful and as successful as those who have gone before us. God bless you.
Home run, that ball's still throwing.
Attention, please. We're not quite finished. This is the last public session of the World Meeting of Families Congress, and I've been tasked with the responsibility of trying to draw things to conclusion. Following this, of course, will be the small group sessions that you're all assigned to. But let me say a few words before you go that direction. Today, for me, and I think for most of us here from what I've heard, is a moment filled with both joy and sadness. Sadness because these last breakout sessions will bring us to the end of the World Meeting of Family Congress, and we've had a wonderful time, haven't we? This family meeting over the past 3 days is the largest in the history of the event since Pope John Paul II founded it. At this point, there have been nearly 20,000 people who've joined us for the World Congress. And it's been a wonderful success because of the energy and enthusiasm you have brought to it. So thank you so very, very much. Now, I pray that each of you, all of us gathered here together, will carry the memories of this meeting, along with the friends we've made here, back to your homes, where they become sources of strength for the future. If what we do here doesn't change your lives and make a difference back home, we wasted our time. So take the energy, enthusiasm, and your friends back with you when you go home. In less than 24 hours, we will gather together to welcome Pope Francis when he arrives in Philadelphia. Tomorrow night, we will have his presence among us for the Festival of Families. And Sunday afternoon, he'll be there for the celebration of Mass. Now, all those events are open for all of us. There's no charge. And we want to show up and celebrate this joy in an extraordinary way. So remember, tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock and on Sunday afternoon, 4 o'clock. The Pope will be around in other places, but those are the two places where he gathers all of us together to celebrate with him. I also want to thank Archbishop Paglia. I think he's here somewhere. I think I saw him. The President of the Pontifical Council for the Family, and all the members of the Pontifical Council. I want to thank all our wonderful speakers. Weren't they all wonderful? But also the translators who have a difficult job, right? The volunteers, the organizational team. But most of all, once again, I want to thank you, the families who came to Philadelphia. Every family who participated made a big difference for this Congress. Some of you traveled very far to be here. All of you contributed to the extraordinary spirit of this gathering. The Church and the people of Philadelphia will always be grateful to you. So thank you very, very much. May God renew your life with his presence, and may St. John Paul II and St. Gianna Mola, the great patron saints of this Congress, keep you safe with their prayers until we meet again in 3 years at the next World Meeting of Families. So now, let's go to those breakout sessions. Have a wonderful time. Enjoy the fellowship, and may God bless all of you. Have a safe trip home on Sunday and Monday.